What are some of the best research experiences for medical school? Hey, BeMo Nation, welcome to another episode of One Question Podcast. We have absolutely nothing to sell you, just pure content. We got lots of tips and strategies that we like to share with you. And we do this because we want to make sure everyone has an equal chance at the medical school admission process. In case you've never watched any of these, I like to tell you that, you know, these are completely unscripted. And the way it works is each week we tackle one hot topic regarding medical school admissions process. And we have only 10 minutes to give you our best strategies and advice because we know you're super busy and you want to get the most important pieces of information and no fluff. And that's exactly what we aim for. Now, keep in mind that these are unscripted. There is no fancy music. There is no fancy visuals. There is no fancy sound effects, just pure content. 10 minutes with pure content. As I mentioned, today we're going to talk about research experience for medical school. And we're going to talk about how to gain such research experience and what are some best research experiences that you could represent in your medical school application process. So, first thing first, we're going to start our timer. There we go. We got 10 minutes. All right. So my name is Behrouz Moemeni. I'm the CEO and founder here at BeMo. And I am joined today with Meng Yang. And she's one of our senior admission experts. And we're going to do a little bit of back and forth to see how you could find the best research experience and what is possibly could be qualified as the best research experience for medical school. So Meng, why don't you tell us a little bit about this topic? Maybe you could first talk about what is literally the best experience. What are medical school admission officers looking for when they say, hey, they want to see that you have some research experience? What is actually, we could even go a little bit further back. Why is this even necessary for a medical doctor?
Okay, well, a lot of medical doctors are involved in research. So obviously, if you have some of those skills going into your medical training, that helps. But even for those who are, you know, purely doing clinical work, there's a lot of transferable research skills that goes into being a good physician, right? Analyzing and interpreting information. That's something that you learn by doing research, reading articles and interpreting that and applying it to your practice, right? And just in general, it's a great exercise of critical reasoning and critical thinking when you engage in research. So I think no matter what kind of physician you are, or actually whatever profession you're in, research experience does help you to develop very essential skills that will help you to succeed in that practice, in that profession.
Yeah, I completely agree with this. You know, a medical doctor absolutely needs to understand where the knowledge for practice is coming from. A practicing physician needs to completely understand how to go and do a literature review, and when presented with literature, be able to review that piece of literature and say whether or not the information presented is sound. Is it statistically significant? Is it large enough of a sample for it to have any impact? Or is it just frivolous? Because 90% of research is frivolous at the end of the day. Just like anything else, 90% is not good. It's just that 10%. And a good medical doctor needs to understand that and be able to, even if doesn't have any sort of research as part of their role, needs to be able to interpret other individuals' research findings. So that's the reason why you have to demonstrate this. This is one of those things that, you know, students cannot fake, because it's going to be obvious if you're just doing it for your application, or no, you have a real interest in this. Because somebody who's just doing it for their application, they do research for like, you know, 8 weeks, and then that's it, you never see it. I don't think that's the best type. Now that we're talking about the best type of research, is one that's been in depth. And, you know, you probably thought before watching this episode that when we were talking about the best type of research experience for medical school, you're going to be like, oh, you know, cancer research or diabetes research. No, no, no. It's not about that at all. It's, hey, how much in depth did you go in? When did you start? Did you start first year? Did you start second year? Did you start third year? Did you start fourth year after getting rejected? So that to try to make up for that experience you didn't have? Those all matter because the duration of commitment shows that, hey, you were interested in this. Like they say, actions speak louder than words. When somebody's committed, they're committed, and it's not just a summer. They just, you know, maybe they started in the summer in their second year, but they continued during their third year, then this continued into the third year's summer months. Then it went all the way to their fourth year. That's a whole different sort of ball game. And then eventually maybe they were even on a publication. They had presentations. They did their own independent research. Those are the things that show you have the qualities, because you want to show that you could analyze data. You want to show that you could interpret literature and search for different pieces of information in the literature. And you also want to show that you could present your data, either in the form of a publication or a research talk. And if you've done it in the short term, it's impossible to show those because you probably don't have that kind of an experience. Mm-hmm. I think that's what I would say about the best type. If you have anything to add, Meng, we also need to discuss how to find research experiences as well. And I can tell you we have less than 5 minutes left.
I'll say one more thing about the best type. A lot of people will think that it's, you know, clinical research that they have to do, just like you said, it has to be cancer, it has to be diabetes, but you can actually branch out, because any research venture you go on will allow you to gain, to do those things that Behrouz was talking about, gathering data, analyzing data, interpreting data, writing up your data, presenting your data. And those are the transferable skills that are most valuable that you would get. And those are the things you should highlight in your application, not the specific topics of research that you end up doing. I think we can now move on to how to get the best research experience. I think an obvious resource is your professors, your TAs. These are people who are probably, very likely, currently engaged in research. Professors for sure. TAs are often grad students who are conducting their own research or part of a lab. They are your most direct and your best resources to seek out these types of opportunities. So it's very important for you to be able to establish good rapport with your professors and your TAs while you're taking courses with them. Make sure you're going into office hours. Make sure you're not just a number to them. Make sure they know your name, they know your face, they know you know, the quality of your work in that class. And then that makes it easier for you to then approach them. Well, first do research on what they're doing research on, and then approach them to say that you're interested, you would love the opportunity to be a part of their lab. Even if you're just doing like very basic footwork at the beginning in their lab, you know, even if you're not directly involved in the research at the lab, getting your foot in the door is very important, and doing so early on is important so that you have the time, as Behrouz had talked about, to progress and increase in your responsibilities.
Yeah, 100% I agree. And, you know, at the beginning, you should be comfortable to participate just as a volunteer. You want the experience. So don't go with the expectation of getting paid, because that is not your end goal anyways. And when you're not asking for pay and you make it clear in your first communication that you're willing to volunteer just because you don't know, especially if it's your first one, and this is the first time you're getting research experience, you need to let the person know that, hey, I'm interested in your research for this and this reason. I like to get involved, but I understand I don't have necessary experience. So yeah, I'm okay just volunteering until I learn a little bit more, until you trust me that I can do a good work, I'm diligent, I pay attention to detail, and I learn things fast. Then later on, if you think that's appropriate, you could pay me appropriately, whatever you think is best. But I'm mostly interested in the experience, and that should genuinely show when you actually get started, because that's more likely for them to keep you. Because that's another thing, getting it is one thing, then keeping that position is another. They have to be satisfied with you to try to advance you and over time give you more and more responsibilities, hopefully an independent research project that gives you that publication, the research presentation, et cetera, all those things that you need in order to have sufficient experience before you create your medical school applications. Any final thoughts?
Yeah, I think if you can think ahead and take all of those steps that we've been, just been talking about, what you'll have at the end is not only great research experience and transferable research skills, you will also likely have a very strong recommendation letter from the individuals who oversaw your work. And so you're coming out of this with a lot that will add to your application.
100%. And I would recommend as a final note that whatever you start with, take your time, make sure it's something you're really interested in so you could be willing to put the time and effort and stay there in the long term. The longer you stay in one position, rather than jumping around over and over and over again, the more likely the person will get to know you and the better a letter of recommendation and the more that you could actually advance in that role, which is really important for your application. With that said, I think that wraps up our one question podcast episode. We have 10 seconds left, so we did not too bad today. Thanks so much for watching. Hopefully you could join us again. If you'd like to join us for the next episode, make sure you subscribe on whatever social media channel or podcast you're watching this. Give this a like, comment, ask your questions, and we hope to see you soon again. Bye-bye.